the power of understanding. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7. Wisdom is supreme, so get wisdom. And if it costs you all you have, get what? Understanding. Understanding has to do with what I call the big picture. The big picture is understanding the intent or the intention of an action. Understanding is never in the hands. It's always in the head. Ideas exist in the head. Ideas deal with finish. The shoe on your feet used to be an idea. The clothing on your back used to be an idea in someone's head. Everything begins with an idea. And when an idea is accepted by the mind, it becomes what they call a precept. Precept is an original idea. When a precept is conceived, it becomes a concept. Concept is a picture of an idea. Concepts, when they are communicated, become words. So a word is an exposed thought. A word is an idea contained. So when you want to communicate ideas, you must use words. When you want concepts to come from your mind to another person's mind, you must use this medium called word. Communication, therefore, depends on agreement of definition of terms, words. For example, I'm from another country, and when I use certain words in my culture, they will not be the same meaning to you in your country, because words come out of culture, because concepts are culture. So the key to communication is having the same meaning of concepts before we start to talk. So if I want to communicate with you, I have to first make sure that my definitions are the same as yours. So the key to successful communication is when my concepts are the same concepts that are in your mind, and the words I use to communicate the concepts are the same in both cultures. When there is a breakdown in the communication of concepts, it is called a misconception. Nothing could be more dangerous than a misconception, because a misconception produces misunderstanding. A misunderstanding can produce wrong ideology, idea only. And you can walk away with the wrong conclusion, which produces a belief system that is contaminated. What you believe and what I believe, we believe. But the question is what you believe the truth? Because you believe something doesn't make it the truth. This is why I am very skeptical in the areas of theology. Because theological ideas are products of culture. In other words, I want to learn the precept, not the concept. Because if I can get the precept, then the concept will be right. Therefore, the belief system will be corrected. And so I want to go back and crawl up in the mind of the person who originated everything. There's nothing on earth more powerful than an idea. Everything on earth is a product of ideas. Everything began as an idea. Everything. We don't think much about the concept of idea, but idea is the source of everything. Ideas are more powerful than death, because death cannot kill an idea. Ideas outlive men. You can kill a man, but you can't destroy his ideas. They are the most powerful thing. They outlive men. They produce everything. Everything comes from them, and we have ignored ideas. Ideas submerge, and they re-emerge in generations. The book of Ecclesiastes is a sarcastic book. In that book, the king says these words: there is nothing new under the sun. In other words, if you think you have a new idea, it was here before. Ideas never die. Just submerge. Ideas control the world. The world is actually ruled by dead men. Democracy was an idea that was invented by Plato. Aristotle debated the idea of democrata. Democrata is a Greek word which we embrace as democracy. Democracy was invented by the Greeks, Greek philosophers, and they all died, but democracy is still here. You cannot kill an idea. And if you kill a person with an idea, the idea usually multiplies. Because it's not the person you're after, it's the idea. And you cannot shoot an idea with a bullet. The most important thing on earth is an idea. John chapter 1. Verse 1 is where the word idea shows up in the Bible. It says, beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God. The New Testament was translated from Hebrew into Greek and Aramaic, and so many of the words in the New Testament in English don't have, in many cases, the full weight of the meaning. This is one of those words that is very weak in the New Testament English translation. The word word in the original Greek language is the word L-O-G-O-S. Logos. The word logos has a meaning. It doesn't mean word. We translate its word. The word logos, original meaning, means expression of an idea. Expressed idea. So when you read that verse in the original transliteration, it doesn't make sense in English. In the beginning was God's expressed idea. And God's idea was with God. And God was his idea. And God idea was in God, and all things were made by God's idea.
You read down verse 12, 13, 14, and God's expression of an idea became flesh. Could you then wrap your mind around it, that Jesus was God's idea on two legs? If you want to know God's ideas, what he thinks about everything, just study Jesus. If you want to know what God is thinking, listen to Jesus. And his first statement was, repent. Repent means to change the way you've been trained to think. Why? For the kingdom of heaven has arrived. The idea of kingdom. What is a kingdom? What is the concept of a kingdom? What is he talking about? And we walk away with contaminated concepts. So we create a religion called Christianity because there's no concept of kingdom in our culture. What was God's original idea? The entire Bible is about a king, a kingdom, and a royal family. If you read the Bible, you'll never find God calling himself a president, or a mayor, or even a senator. He doesn't even call himself a prime minister or a premier. He uses the word king. Your education has no trace of king in it. And yet you read a Bible about a king. With a kingdom. Wonder there is great opportunity for misconception. Brave misunderstanding that produces wrong conclusions that become belief systems. God was the first one to create a kingdom. It is called the kingdom of heaven. The Bible says God created the heavens and he is the king of heaven. The problem with heaven for us is it's invisible, but it is real. Heaven is more real than earth. Heaven is more substance than the physical world. The Bible says that which is seen was made by that which is unseen. And that which is seen is temporal, but that which is unseen is eternal. So the physical universe, 500 million galaxies that we're still counting, all of that is not as real as heaven. And when you read the Bible, you read strange things like this. In the book of Psalm 115, you turn there right now. Psalm 115, verse 16, it says, the Lord created the heavens and he made the earth. The highest heavens belong to the Lord. Verse 16, and the earth he gave to the children of men. He gave dominion to you over the earth. The word dominion, right away, dominion, this word in the Hebrew language, Genesis 1:26, is the word R-A-D-A-H, Radha. Sometimes it's spelled R-A-W-D-A-W, depending on the translator. The word Radha, R-A-D-A-W, simply means kingdom. Let them have Radha, kingdom. First thing God gave humans over earth is kingdom. A kingdom is the governing influence of a king over a territory, impacting it with his will, his purposes, intent, producing a citizenship of people who reflect his culture and nature, and who develop his established kingdom in that territory. In other words, a kingdom is literally a government impacting a territory. A kingdom is completely opposite to a republic. It is completely opposite to a democracy. And so the book in your hand you call a Bible is being read by someone trained in democracy and